Our exhibition is titled Chaos and Classicism, Art in France, Italy, and Germany, 1918 to 1936. We take the visitor from the period of the armistice of World War I in 1918 to the time of the Berlin Olympic Games in 1936. And it is a mixed media show, painting, sculpture, decorative arts, film, and photography. The chaos of our title refers to the death and destruction of World War I, as exemplified by Otto Dix's brutal and extraordinary print series, Der Krieg, or War. The classicism of our title is equally represented by Mayol's beautiful classicizing figure, Ile-de-France, representing the central area of the French countryside, and his answer, as it were, for the death and destruction of the war through the beauty of French art and classical aesthetics.
A historian named Barbara Tuchman, several decades ago, who said that in August 1914, the lights went out all over Europe. And I think there's a way in which World War I, in a sense, changed everything. It still remains, in some ways, the most traumatic event of the 20th century. It created both a European population that was traumatized by the effects of the war, and also in many ways produced, obviously, hope for a new post-war age that would in fact be dedicated to self-determination and progress and social welfare.
Fascinating phenomenon comes to the fore after the First World War, which is a movement against pre-war experimentalism on the part of the European avant-garde. So that in Paris, there is a powerful anti-cubist direction. In Italy, there is a powerful anti-futurist movement. And in Germany, expressionism has now been pushed aside in favor of Neusachlichkeit, or what is called new objectivity. Their desire is not to turn their back on the present, but to find a way to integrate the past of art, the traditions of art, with modern expression. Picasso's example was formative. In a work like La Source, for example, Picasso actually creates a figure that talks about sources of art. The term La Source, in fact, is a pun in French art. It means literally a stream, and at the same time, it stands for the source of European culture, for the source of civilization. Sculpture becomes an especially important medium between the two world wars because it is the three-dimensional representation of humanity at its idealized best. BCA's painting of the sculptor in his self-portrait is a prime example of this desire to remake the self in a more durable form. In fact, it's interesting that BCA, the painter, has the sculptor as his artistic paradigm between the wars. He who makes three-dimensional versions of humanity in an idealized and perfected form.
One of the characteristics of this interwar period is the fascination, the obsession with the body and also with health and hygiene and fitness, common to both left and right. It really transgressed all conventional political lines.
For the left, it is about strengthening and beautifying the working class, the proletariat. And for the right wing, especially with the Italian fascists and eventually the Nazis, it is about a collectivity that will be powerful enough to do battle with the rest of society. This artistic idea becomes, in many ways, a politicized idea in the hands of the extreme left and the extreme right. In Leo Breuer's Coal Man, you see an example of the urban proletariat, long-suffering, enduring, but powerful, a massive figure with this endless and repetitive task of bringing coal up from and to the basements of German buildings. He represents the power of the proletariat and the nobility of the working class in the face of their downtrodden status. The right-wing obsession with the human body between the wars, in the case of Mussolini, is an obsession with the antique past, with the greatness of Rome. His model, of course, is Roman art, splendid statuary of the ancient Romans. He tries to emulate that and have his artists emulate that. The continuous profile of Mussolini stands for the all-seeing, all-knowing, all-powerful fascist dictator. The classical revival between the wars in Europe is a real boon for designers and architects. The vocabulary, which was so well known in the West, provided modern practitioners with an enormous kind of lexicon of forms that they could adapt for modern usage. Ruhlmann picks out the Ionic capital in ivory dots on the back of his beautiful set of dining chairs. Madeleine Vionnet takes the classical idea to the realm of high fashion. Her splendid red caftan dress is a perfect example in which she has used Greek and Roman draping for modern dresses for modern women. Mies van der Rohe, Le Corbusier, and Tarragni all are fascinated by the idea of fusing antique and classical architecture and design with modern aesthetics. All three of them talk a great deal about the beauty of geometric solids and the order that they find in classical aesthetics, and all desire to find a way that the beauty of the machine and modernity of industry itself can be combined with classical aesthetics in order to create a new and powerful modern paradigm. By no means did all artists in Europe between the wars embrace the classical revival. And an artist like Hannah Hirsch, in her painting Roma, goes to great lengths to make fun of Mussolini and his entire obsession with the revival of the Roman Empire. You see the Duce and the Danish film star, Asta Nielsen, with their heads incongruously placed on top of the bodies of bathing beauties as they stand in the context of the Roman cityscape that includes parts of the Roman Forum. Classicism finds its way into all kinds of work that you might, on first glance, not expect to find it. Balthus's great painting, The Street, for instance, is a work that actually recalls, intentionally on the part of Balthus, the art of Piero della Francesca, 15th century, early Renaissance Italian painter. Balthus is painting the street, as it were, synthesizes the everyday life of the modern Parisian neighborhood with a kind of stability, a kind of frozen, timeless quality of the art of Piero della Francesca, finding a way, as it were, to synthesize the ancient and the modern in a single work.
In a sense, what the interwar period produces, and particularly Weimar, is a whole range of discourses about health and hygiene that become available. And one example of that we can see is the enormous interest in sports. There's a real kind of culture of celebrity and stars and star athletes and spectator sports.
The artists are fascinated by the idea of sport, along with everyone else. From the left of the political spectrum, there's an artist like Baumeister, who's terrific, abstracting, almost cubist painting of a rope jumper, is a wonderful homage to the contemporary fascination with sport from the left, because the socialists were talking a great deal about the need to have healthy working men and women. If you look at the right, of course, the Nazis are making images of German supermen and women. A good example is Janisch's water sports, in which you see a veritable army of German athletes paddling, rowing, sailing their ways across the painting in preparation for this international Olympic competition.
The willingness of the Nazi Party, and of Adolf Hitler in particular, to host the Berlin Olympics in 1936 is just one more example of the kind of plasticity and the capaciousness, in many ways, of National Socialist ideology and politics. The Olympics were associated with internationalism, the desire for peace and cooperation among nations, with good sportsmanship, none of these being qualities that the Nazis privileged.
Adolf Hitler's fascination with a kind of idealized, perfected humanity, which he thinks is embodied in the Aryan. In fact, he says and believes that Aryans are the genetic inheritors of the ancient Athenians, and thus he wants to create a new modern race as beautiful and perfect as he believes the ancient Greeks and Romans were. Chaos and Classicism is really an opportunity for the public to see works that are little known, and that has certainly been true for me as a curator as well. Very exciting to discover works and to be able to exhibit works that the public is unfamiliar with. I hope that the public comes away from this exhibition with a sense of the 1920s and 30s that is fuller than that they've had in the past. I think the richness of the period in part is owed to this powerful classical revival that has barely been treated by museums in large-scale exhibitions.